Okay, I think we're going to get started, everybody. We're a couple minutes late, but we'll catch up, I'm sure. First, a little housekeeping item, which was for anybody who might have arrived late this morning because of TTC delays or such things, the plenary session will be online, so you can catch yourself up. I think it'll be up by late this afternoon. So I'll first introduce myself, a slight change from the program. My name is Michelle Rossi. I'm the Director of Policy and Strategy at Health Quality Ontario. And one of the activities I participated in last year was being part of a small team that provided support to the QCIPA review panel. So I'm really happy today that we've got four people who have had a range of experiences with QCIPA here to talk about it, talk a little bit about the review, you know, what sort of brought the review about, what informed it, and then looking forward at what might come out of the recommendations of that review. I'm going to do a quick round of introductions before we move into the substance of our panel, just so that you're familiar with all of our panelists. I'll start with Dr. Andreas Lapakis. Dr. Lapakis is a general internist, and he's the executive director of the Li Ka-shing Knowledge Institute at St. Michael's Hospital. He's a professor in the Faculty of Medicine at the University of Toronto. He's a health services researcher and also does health research in public engagement. He's got a lengthy and impressive CV. He's also the chair of the Board of Health Quality Ontario. He's a board member of Cancer Care Ontario. He's the founder and chief editor of Healthy Debate, a website that everybody should be reading, and also a newer initiative called the Faces of Healthcare, which if you Google, you'll also be taken to quite a treasure trove of inspirational stories about patients and providers in our healthcare system. Sharon Nettleton is a founding member of Patients for Patient Safety Canada and is currently one of its co-chairs. She has many, many personal and professional experiences that have grounded her knowledge in patient safety and patient engagement, including forming one of Canada's first patient and family safety councils. You know, Sharon, I'm especially pleased to have join us because she's participated in the development and the evaluation of a number of toolkits related to disclosure of harm and incident analysis and management. Tara McCarville is the VP of Quality, Risk, and Business Intelligence at Trillium Health Partners and has 15 years of experience leading quality improvement initiatives in the private, public, and nonprofit health sectors. So Tara's worked in a number of organizations in all of those sectors, has an MBA, and has led a number of really interesting initiatives related to the application of QCIPA at Trillium. And Patrick Hawkins is a partner in the Health Law Group at Bordner, Ladner, Gervais. He's a civil litigator. He specializes in health law and personal injury defense. He's got more than 20 years experience basically representing, you know, hospitals, other healthcare facilities in professional malpractice litigation and with a wide variety of litigation and policy matters. And I think he's a foremost expert in the application of QCIPA in sort of this real-world environment, and he's called upon by many to comment. So we're grateful to have the panel here today. We're going to talk about, as I said, the process of the review and the importance of considering this balance between provider and patient needs when analyzing incidents, and how a law like QCIPA can be used to promote safety, but also in a way that patients and families find, you know, useful and acceptable and that they're engaged in. So really briefly, I think most of you know what QCIPA is. It's a provincial law, and it gives organizations the capacity to undertake activities under a certain structure that that gives them protection of some information that's collected under that structure. Which means that that information can't be disclosed in legal or disciplinary proceedings. So the objective is to support improvement in the interests of patient safety. You know, there wasn't, I don't think everyone would agree, there's no intent to prevent or impede transparency or hide behavior, but there's been a widespread variation in the application of QCIPA, and it's raised questions about its use. So there was a review, most of you know. The report has been publicly posted. There were about a dozen recommendations. And the panel that was co-chaired by Andreas, along with Angela More, who is a patient representative, decided to focus because of the issues I think that brought the panel together, and also for rational reasons of time and that sort of thing, really focused on the application of QCIPA to critical incidents. QCIPA is used in other ways, for instance, to conduct various quality improvement activities. Some people hold their morbidity and mortality rounds under a QCIPA committee structure, but this committee focused on critical incidents. Most of you know there's an actual definition of critical incidents in the Public Hospitals Act, they really had a lot of discussion about the merits of continuing to have a law like QCIPA. And that was a big point of discussion for the committee, and a really central recommendation of the committee was that it should be kept in some form, but really we needed to narrow its use, and there is a place for it, but it needs to be, that place needs to be defined more clearly and consistently. So we wanted to provide some examples of critical incidents, just to sort of bring the definition to life. I mean, essentially, it's an unintended event that occurs when a patient receives treatment, in this case in a hospital, that A, results in death or serious disability, injury, or harm to the patient, and B, does not result primarily from the patient's underlying medical condition or from a known risk inherent in providing the treatment. So that seems like a clear definition, but there is still some subjectivity and ambiguity there, which I'm sure we'll speak about later. And Tara from Trillium had provided this slide, and I thought it was a really useful illustration, and it's examples of critical incidents that her hospital has looked into, and we thought it provided a good sense of what might be happening in a large community hospital in Ontario, and also really associates these incidents with people who are experiencing them, and we thought sort of humanized the more clinical definition. So the way we're going to do this panel is sort of a series of interviews. We'd like it to be a conversation and stimulate some thought, and then turn it over to the audience for questions. So I'm going to start with Andreas, and I guess ask you off the bat, what surprised you most as you undertook the review of QCIPA?
Thanks. Good morning, everybody. This is a series of interviews where you know what the questions are going to be before they come, so it's great. And just by way of introduction, I co-chaired the panel. Patrick was on it as well, and I practice palliative care at St. Michael's Hospital now, but actually I've never had any formal role in investigating critical incidences in a hospital, so just to kind of put that out there. So some of you may be surprised that I was surprised by what I was surprised by, but here it goes. I mean, the three things that surprised me the most was the incredible variability in the use of QCIPA in hospitals across this province. I remember very well, I did about six interviews with CEOs, and I literally talked to one CEO in a fairly large hospital in this province who said, I could not get my docs to even talk about investigating a critical incident if I didn't put everything under QCIPA. And I hung up the phone and I started dialing to the next CEO, and he said, we can't stand QCIPA. We find that it screws up our culture. We virtually never use it. Like, unbelievable variation, and actually great confidence that what they're doing is right and what the other folks are doing isn't right, frankly. So I was just really surprised by that. And to be honest, when we one of the things I'm really proud of the panel is we had a full day with patients who had had experience, and caregivers who had had experience with critical incidences. And it's not surprising to me that they sort of said, we just find it odd and kind of suspicious, frankly, that there is this variation. We don't understand why it should be. So that's number one. Number two was as best I can sort out, almost total lack of sharing of learnings from hospitals, one hospital with another hospital. And I think, again, you would think that if You know, there's a suicide attempt in someone who's admitted to perhaps an observed ward. That, I'm sure, is not the only one that probably happened in the province that year. And my sense is, right now, hospitals aren't sharing with each other what the outcomes of their investigations are, which I would argue is pretty important. And then thirdly, and it just actually personally, I was the one day we had with the patients, I was surprised, but when I reflected on it, I understood why. I was surprised by their real, real desire to have a kind of court a second opinion. In other words, if we go through the process in my hospital, you know, frankly, it does sometimes feel as if the hospital is investigating itself. I mean, we're maybe not 100% sure that we kind of are getting the fair shake here. We really do think it's important that under certain circumstances that, you know, patients can go to, whether it be an ombudsman or to get a second opinion. And I guess I'd naively sort of worked in hospitals where I thought we kind of tried to investigate these things in a really open manner, and I was initially sort of surprised by that. But the more I think about it, most things in our society, there is a, you know, recourse to a second opinion, and that's actually one of the reasons we as a panel recommended that. So those are the three surprises.
And I just have one follow-up, which is about the just culture, and that was a concept that was highlighted in the report and seemed to really inform the direction of the recommendations. And I just wondered if you could take a couple minutes to talk about what the just culture is and why it was so important.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's hard to describe culture, but we all know culture is super important, right? And it wasn't us that came up with the term just culture. It had been in the literature before. But I think one of the things that really struck me, if you read our report, we described six principles that we thought should underlie the investigation and reporting to patients and their families of critical incidences. And the exact wording of every one of those six principles came from the patients. We didn't edit one word of those. And the first principle actually was something like assume good intentions from all parties. Like, go into this assuming that people, you know, the hospitals are trying to figure out genuinely what went wrong, to genuinely try to improve. The patients are genuinely trying to understand what happened and are hoping that it won't happen to someone else's loved one, but they're not necessarily trying to kind of shame and blame you. So I think that's sort of what the just culture is. Setting a culture that would encourage, like, it's pretty brave to stick all of those critical incidences up there, right? And in a bit of the shame and blame culture, one might say, holy shit, this is a crappy hospital. It's got all these problems. But in a just culture, I think you would say, wow, it's a hospital that's actually willing to identify them, willing to look at them, willing to publicly share them, willing to explain to the patients to whom this happened what happened, and willing to talk about what they're going to do to try and prevent it happening again. So. I think the just culture affects patients so that they would feel that they're listened to, that they know what's going on, that they're interviewed, that the results of the investigation are explained to them, that the clinicians who work there can sort of assume that they're going to be assumed to be competent unless it's clearly different, that they're going to be supported rather than blamed, that they're going to be supported emotionally when these are hard things to be a clinician and have happen. And I think also, I'll just end also the media. I think there sometimes is a bit of a kind of blame and shame thing in the media where sometimes we should be saying, well, it's good for institutions to come forward publicly and sort of recognize and admit where things go wrong and went wrong and to commit to improvement.
Thanks. Patrick, you've watched, you know, many hospitals grapple with you know, quality of care issues. What have some of your key observations been as you observe this over your career?
I'm going to say that the two most frequent questions that I get asked and that clients come to me or hospitals come to me with questions about, I'll say probably the first one, and looking at this slide of critical incidents, the first one is, what is a critical incident? And is this a critical incident? And do we have to apply all of the requirements in the Public Hospitals Act? So is this a critical incident? And there's been an awful lot of debate about the definition of critical incident, and as we look at some of those, fall with fractured hip not diagnosed until 7 days later. Is the fall, patient in hospital who suffers a fall and fractures, is that a critical incident or is that a part of the underlying disease process? And unless we, you know, restrain or detain all of our elderly patients, falls are going to happen. Suicide attempts, we've had the debate around whether a suicide attempt is a part of the disease process of mental illness, or as it's now called, it's a never event. And that's, you know, the recent publication from a couple of weeks ago says that should be a never event. So that's the most frequent question I ask, is this a critical incident? What I always try to get back to people who are looking at it is in something like that is, even if this is a known risk, or even if this is an underlying risk, or you can make that argument, what's the harm here and what has actually happened to the patient? And when you're dealing with something like a fall or you're dealing with something like a suicide attempt, that should be treated as a critical incident, even if you can argue that it's not, and treated as a critical incident for purposes of your investigation, for purposes of your disclosure. So that's where there's been a lot of debate. I'll say the second most frequent question I get to ask is, do we need the protection and how should we be investigating this? And I think people still have a lot of trouble with that and trouble with when and how to invoke or do we need a particular protection. And I'll say there, and it sort of comes back to some of Andrea's remarks around culture, I'll say the biggest concerns that I see coming out of hospitals are more individual related as opposed to institutional related. And it's the individual concerns when an incident has happened around discipline internally and college proceedings that tend to drive the need for protection more so than, I'll call it, institutional liability or sort of legal concerns around a lawsuit. And I think the question to ask is, have you created a culture where the individual can bring forward their own errors or their own faults and engaged in a self-critical process without a fear of unjust or unfair retribution or consequences? And if you've created a culture without fear, I think there's less need for protection. And on the other hand, if you've got more fear and unclear discipline indicators and unclear what you're going to do with it, the individuals are going to be asking for greater protection. Another key in the process, I'll say, is your relationships with your organized groups of staff, your unionized staff, your nurses and other healthcare professionals, and your medical staff. And if you've got relationships that are good, that are supportive of a culture of looking at these things without unfair consequences, then I think, again, there's less need for protection.
And so can you share, as many of you will know, there's been some new legislation that's been introduced. So could you share whether, you think the new legislation will, you know, help? I mean, laws can take us a certain distance, and beyond that, it rolls into matters of culture and implementation. But do you have any comments on the bill?
One of the challenges that we really had with QCIPA is it landed at the same time as discussions around patient safety and adverse event disclosure to patients were starting to gain a lot more momentum and speed. It also lands around the same time that as a public and as a legislature, there's a more focus on accountability and transparency. So constantly trying to balance the need to protect in certain circumstances with the need to disclose and the important mandate to disclose and tell our patients what happened. I think one of the greatest challenges associated with QCIPA, and as we looked at looked at it in the review committee, is there is nothing in the legislation that talks about disclosure to patients, and there was nothing in the legislation that created that balance. And what I think is really good in the new legislation is that the balance is written in specifically into the purposes of the legislation, which was brought out, I guess it's about 2 to 3 weeks ago. It's still before the legislature, but subject to committee process and any amendments. I think we can expect in a majority government it is going to pass. But the balance is written in there, and the balance is specifically written in that says we have to disclose to patients or their authorized representatives. We should include them in the critical incident review processes, which I think is another great, great advancement in it. But recognizes that we sometimes need protection, or we sometimes need an environment where staff can feel safe and comfortable to come forward and have these fulsome discussions. So I really like the balance that's being written into the legislation, and I really like that there is now specific reference to and specific mention of what can and should be disclosed to patients, as opposed to trying to grapple with a legislation that doesn't talk about it at all.
So that's a great segue, to Sharon, who I'm hoping can give us some good advice on how to effectively engage patients and families when an incident has occurred, given this new focus and this dialogue on ensuring that patients are well engaged.
Thank you. I just want to say it's a privilege to be a patient and a family member on this panel, because I think that's the first step of engagement. We have to be part of the process. And part of that process is in actually helping to design the system. So the whole process, I think, that Ontario has taken is very invigorating. It's leading edge. Keep up the great work. And I certainly feel the momentum. In terms of best advice, I think one of my key messages to all of you is you're going to have to fight that natural reaction in incident management, which is the normal human reaction of flight and fight. So when something unexpected occurs, when you're seeing your patients, family members go through an unexpected event, that natural reaction is to either run away, make yourself scarce, in the organization, in the institution, as caregivers. But the natural, I guess, way patients and families want to see our health system respond is for you to be there for us, is for you to connect with us. So, and making that connection happen as soon as possible. So that initial connection is something that intuitively we have to work against our natural reactions. So that's one of my tips. The second is don't be afraid of the acknowledgement. We're not sure initially as organizations, even as patients and family members, what has happened, how it happened, to make sure that it doesn't happen again and that there is an investigation. So acknowledgement is really key and critical. We can see that something awry has occurred. We can feel it. We can sense this. So please acknowledge. The explanation of the process is something that's very foreign to us. It's second nature to healthcare organizations, to risk managers, to lawyers, to physicians and other caregivers, but it's not second guess, or it's not it's not a normal process for us. So we need the information, we need the explanations, and we need to hear it more than once. So another, I guess, key tip in all of this is provide the information to us in multiple forms. So face-to-face, great. A brochure, a pamphlet is something else that might be another good tip. And then finally, I would say, help us understand what our role is as patients and family members in the process, and that we have a role to play in the process. And certainly really important in this piece of legislation to know that patients and families will be part of the investigation, that what we have seen, what we feel, what we know to be true or to be part of the facts will be heard and listened to. So make sure that information is shared with us. And then finally, I'd say assigning a liaison to us as patients and families, because some of these processes of investigating incidents are quite long. So making sure that even after that initial contact, that there is someone who's going to guide us through the process. And a number of these steps actually are outlined in the Canadian Incident Analysis Framework. There's a whole appendix on key tips, but I think those are the highlights that I'm willing to share with you right now.
Thanks, Thanks, Sharon. And could you speak a little bit about the power dynamic between the patient and the provider when an incident's occurred and it's being analyzed? And if there's anything that you think we collectively can do to try to minimize this imbalance for patients?
Yeah, it's a really good question, because the power dynamic to us is very real. Remember, we're coming into your organizations, your care centers, your clinics, when we're most vulnerable, when we're not well. And our expectations is at least to maintain the health or poor health that we have, if not get better. So when that expectation isn't met, we're even more vulnerable. And so working against that power dynamic, there's a number of things you can do. So I'm going back to that first point of actually being present, connecting with us, acknowledging. That's key and really critical to us. I would say the other piece in all of this, too, is don't outnumber us. You know, that power dynamic is often seen when you provider up or even lawyer up. We are in a room as a patient or family member to hear about the incident, to understand next steps, or even to find out in those reports what you found out. And if we are one of many, again, that power dynamic is there. So invite us to bring another person with us. I've seen a family come together and actually outnumber the providers and lawyers in the room, and good on them. So make sure that the patient and family member has an advocate, has a friend. Invite them to bring others. Explaining the procedure ahead of time, explaining the process ahead of time is another way to help us ease into this process. And sharing information ahead of time too. Reports, correspondence, patient records, making sure that we have access to information that caregivers, care providers, administrators, risk managers, and lawyers have ahead of time as well. So those are some of the hot tips there.
So Tara, maybe now you can tell us in some practical ways what kind of initiatives you've got underway at Trillium that you think have contributed to better identification and learning from incidences, and what role you think a piece of legislation like QCIPA plays in, you know, relative to other influences within an organization.
Sure. Thanks everybody for coming. Could you give me a show of hands on who actually is from the hospital environment? I think that would be helpful, because, okay, great. So more than half. So be interested in the discussion after we finish the panel. So some of you will know in the room that Trillium Health Partners almost 3 years ago, it was essentially a merger of two different organizations. Trillium Health Center, which was two sites, one at Queensway, one at Mississauga Hospital, and then a third Credit Valley Hospital. So we're three sites. The size of our hospital is approximately 1,200 acute care beds. So we're fairly large, and we have long-term care also and several other ambulatory services. So we see a lot of patients. I guess that's a little bit of context. Why the merger is important is following merger, we basically had two very different culture on how QCIPA was applied. In one of the hospital systems, QCIPA was applied all the time. In another of the hospital systems, it was rarely applied. So over the last couple of years, it's been an interesting journey for us to bring those two cultures together. And while this panel had gone and developed recommendations, it made it and it really brought it to the forefront for our organization. So we were just prior post-merger, we were trying to define what was our safety culture in the organization. Everyone knows that post-merger, sometimes you just adopt the culture of another organization. We tried to take a slightly different approach at Trillium, which was, let's not just adopt the dominant culture, but yet decide what kind of culture we wanted to have post-merger as Trillium Health Partners. So we worked very hard to try to develop what we believe is a good step forward in the just culture that Andreas referred to. how we did that is we spent a tremendous amount of time, I think, educating and answering a lot of questions about what QCIPA was and wasn't. Like Andrea said it in his opening remarks, we were very surprised as a small group on how much misinformation there was on what actually QCIPA protected and didn't protect. And we found that we spent a lot of time with, we started with physician leadership, and then we talked to division heads, and then we talked to other change agents we felt in the organization, and also in the programs where a lot of incidents occur, whether they're critical or not, a lot of incidents occur, so our higher risk programs. And we received a lot of advice, and we spent a lot of time talking about, you know, QCIPA doesn't actually protect against the facts of the case. And that really opened up a dialogue for us and allowed us to have some really great engagement of physicians at Trillium. And they really helped us, I think, help develop this culture. And it's still under development. It's not perfect, and we still have a lot of work to do. But what it did is we starting with that leadership helped us figure out where would be our barriers and what challenges we were going to have to try to preempt those and involve the people who were concerned about the legislation, either over or under use of the legislation at Trillium Health Partners. So that was what we did, I think, to start the culture conversation. And then what we also did is we implemented, the first system we implemented cross-site as a new organization was our incident reporting system. So it allowed us, we called it advancing safety culture, and what it allowed us to do was to train everyone on the front line about what is an incident. We had lots of dialogue around what an incident was, what makes a critical incident versus another incident. We mirrored how we track those against the World Health Organization, and it gave us an opportunity to have that discussion. So I think it was a very engaged group. And I think following that, I think later we're going to talk a little bit about our process on how we talk about and do a little bit of incident analysis, and I'd be interested in some feedback from the group on how you do it in your hospitals. But that helped us, I think, really set the culture. So the culture was driving the application of QCIPA rather than the other way around. So
culture is key.
Culture is key.
And so the review identified, as Andreas mentioned, at the right at the outset, that we don't do a very good job of sharing learnings mm-hmm. across the province. And so, as somebody kind of working in this area, what would your advice be, and what would be useful to you in terms of being able to share the learnings from your analyses and then taking in the learnings from others?
So we try to share where there's structure in place to share. So ISMP is a place that we share incidents. We share incidents related to medication errors because there is structure in place to do that. Very interestingly, we had, because we are a large community hospital and we're tertiary care, we do need to transfer patients to downtown Toronto on occasion. And we had a major incident, was not deemed a critical incident in the end, but we do similar investigations, whether they're deemed critical or not, that was in partnership with another hospital. And that was a great learning for us on how do you determine whether or not and how to effectively share incidents. Databases unless it's pushed to you, many of you are in the hospital sector, there's not a lot of time during the day to search databases to find out how did someone prevent suicidation here or there. I think what we found is really trying to determine where there are similar issues or challenges with like organizations, and then having the dialogue from there. So that's something that we learned kind of backwards a little bit, because we had an incident in a partnership with another hospital, and there were some great learnings associated with that.
Thanks. So now I'm hoping we can sort of move maybe down the row from Patrick toward me, to have the panelists offer some advice on some of the key considerations that we need to be thinking about as we work to reduce the variation that we see across the province, across all facets of incident analysis and in the application of of a law like QCIPA, which, I mean, I think from Tara's comments, we can all understand it's just part of the solution to incident analysis and one of the tools in the toolkit.
So to start, I'll say a key consideration and to reduce, yeah.
I'll get it.
The fruit flies.
There's a fruit fly slider. Or we're seeing things. sorry, to sort of to reduce the variation, I'm going to say develop a process internally that asks the question early on, does this need to be a protected review? Do we need the protection? And if so, why do we need the protection? And figuring out internally within your own framework, but also making it a part of the policy framework or the process, which is to decide and ask yourself the question rather than just starting down, you know, down the path and automatically making it QCIPA or automatically making it non-QCIPA, is actually ask the question, do we need it and why? And taking it from there.
Maybe just two comments. One is around the variation, which, as I mentioned, I think is huge, and I think probably from a patient and even a provider point of view is probably unacceptable. We struggled a bit as a panel about whether we should sort of say, like, this is a description of the circumstances under which QCIPA should be used, and these are not. And we decided not to go there because we felt every organization, as we just heard, was at such a different level of their culture that that might actually do more harm than good. But I got to tell you, there's some people that looked at our draft recommendations and said, like, you guys are wimping out a bit here. So I think a message is, and even from someone like myself who co-chaired the panel, I believe in the hospitals, patients, the whole community getting together and starting to share the stories that we just heard from Tara on a provincial basis, and to start to decrease that variation on a provincial basis together. But my sense is that there's, like, people aren't going to put up with this for, like, more than 18 months or whatever. I think we kind of got to get our act together as a system. So that's sort of one point. The other one is around the registry, and you know, when I did talk to people, they sort of said, yeah, we put the ISMP is a medication one, right? And they say, yeah, we submit stuff there, but, you know, frankly, we never look ourselves there, actually. And so my thought, perhaps it's a extra little bit of bureaucracy, but is that we do need a place where these lessons learned are shared and shared regularly. And I think it's actually mandated in the draft legislation, so it's going to happen. But I almost think that you need someone whose job it is to look at the things that are coming into that registry and actually reach out to the institutions and sort of say, hey, you know, we've looked at the registry and there's 10 of these things that have been reported, and our sense is that the ability to prevent these is actually fairly straightforward, and you should know about them. And the final comment I make is, you know, if I was on the board, if I chaired the board of my hospital's quality committee, I'd probably say to the person who kind of I'm dealing with in the hospital is that I want to hear about your incidents, but I also just, every time we meet, I just want to hear that you actually have looked at that provincial registry, and you've just tell me what you've learned from that, and is there anything you're implementing here that comes out of that?
You sound like my board quality chair.
I'm not looking for a job.
She's awesome. We're going to keep her. So where to begin? I guess I think it might be helpful to very quickly share how we decide whether or not to apply or how we apply QCIPA. So I'll do it very briefly, and then we can, if there are questions, I can get into them. So for context, since merger, we've applied QCIPA in fewer than 3% of the time since merger. So basically our process is this. An incident occurs on the front line. If it has major harm, we pull together a small group of leaders in the organization within 5 days of the incident occurring over a very quick telephone call, where we answer four questions. The first is the quality department does a review of the case. We walk through the case.
very briefly. We ask four questions. The first is, do you think this incident do you think we should bring the care team together to do an incident analysis on this incident whereby systems or process improvement opportunities may be identified? The second is, if the answer is yes, what is the scope of that analysis? The third is, does anyone on the call believe that QCIPA should be applied as part of this incident analysis? And last but not least, we read out the definition of critical incident in the Public Hospitals Act and determine whether or not it is a critical incident. So critical incident definition comes last, QCIPA comes before that. In the event that that group does recommend that QCIPA be applied, what we then do is have the chief of the program where the incident occurred come and have another meeting or telephone call with myself in my role as VP Quality, the Chief of Staff and the Chief Nursing Executive, where the Chief presents the case for why QCIPA is required in order to generate the systems and process improvement learnings that we are trying to generate. So this is, we found a very rigorous process and has helped us in further developing a good culture around and conversation and accountability from a program and physician leadership perspective as it pertains to QCIPA, and also I think is very focused on the patient and ensuring that we are focused on generating those systems and process improvements as a result of the incident that occurred. From a reporting perspective, as is required by legislation, all critical incidents do come up to the board, whereby we then also provide an update to the board on the status of implementation of the recommendations that have come forward. And they're a pretty great board, and they're pretty tough on us if we're not implementing the recommendations as came out through the incident analysis that was driven by the frontline providers who were involved in any of those incidents. So they hold us accountable to those, but I couldn't agree more with Andreas that we could take this to the next level if we shared this information between hospitals, not only in Ontario, but I think more broadly across the country, because there are so many similarities.
I'm just going to say briefly two things. One is I think we're at a point from a patient and family perspective where we need the information about the process. So often we don't understand why some things are protected and why things aren't protected. When you use that language, protected, it sounds like you're keeping things from us, the facts, the truth. The improvements and certainly what happened. So I think codifying some of this in terms of public documents, brochures, pamphlets, A, to understand the process and B, explanations of the process. The Jewish General Hospital has started this. They've got a brochure and pamphlet for all patients and families that outline what disclosure is and the hospital's responsibilities. And so I would encourage you to have a look at it. But I think the next step is to go a bit further and understand the bigger process and understand terminology like protection and why you need it and what it's all about. Because it does sound, when you use that word, it sounds from a citizen perspective, patient and family, that you're keeping things from us and we want to know why. So that's the first thing, information. And secondly, I think a process from the patient and family perspective about the incident. So great to know that there's calls, there's providers, there's VPs, there's people acting very quickly, but don't forget us as the patients and families in the process, and make sure you you assign someone to be representing us and connecting with us in that process. I'm also going to throw out another idea. Some hospitals are flirting with it right now, and that is to include a patient or family, not the one impacted by the incident, but to include a patient or family perspective as part of the incident analysis. And back to that point about changing the power dynamic, you're also including us or a representative of us in overseeing the process.
So we're going to turn the floor over to you shortly. I just have one more kind of theme to raise with the panel for anybody who would like to comment. And this is about how to better support staff during the analysis of incidents and when incidents happen. It's the sort of second victim phenomena that comes up that I think is really crucial. You know, I think it's frequently said that, you know, in other industries, when a major incident happens, usually that person kind of removes themselves for a little bit, and they've, you know, they usually undergo some kind of process before they sort of hit the field again. But in healthcare, you know, very frequently people are right back on the floor in the operating room, sometimes even the same day. So I just wondered if anyone on the panel wanted to comment about how, while we try to do better on the application of QCIPA, do better engaging patients and families, what can we also do for our staff?
I'll start by saying that I think we have a few people in our organization who do this well, but we need more of them. I think we're, especially coming from the recommendations from the panel and what Sharon just mentioned in terms of engagement of patients through the process, that's a skill set that we need to build within, I can say, within the quality department to do that better. We have an incredible skill in our patients' relations department on how we do that, but less so from a quality and incident analysis and how do you effectively engage patients or families through that process. So I think that's important. With respect to the provider, we need to do better there. I find that the culture is still, you know, pull yourself up by the bootstraps and get back in there. And as an industry, we need to change that a little bit. We probably do better in our organization on the staff, like the nursing and the allied health side, than we do on the physician side, in providing, you know, employee assistance programs. And, you know, we have debrief sessions with skilled people who allow, we find those sessions, actually doing the incident analysis sessions themselves, to be incredibly therapeutic. Nine times out of 10, there is a tremendous amount of emotion. There's a lot of tears around those tables. So our group has gotten fairly good at managing that, but we need to do better, and we don't have enough people who do that well in our organization yet. So I'd love to see a focus on helping health services providers do that better.
I mean, number 12 of our 12 recommendations was to institute some kind of, we were pretty sort of vague about it, to be honest, but some kind of province-wide support for staff and physicians and others who have been involved in critical incidents. I mean, I can say as a physician who graduated in 1979, I mean, I infused TPN into someone's pleural space when I was a resident at Dalhousie in 1979, and I remember it like it was yesterday. Like, I didn't read the x-ray right, and I still, it's the thing I remember the most out of by my year of internship at Dalhousie. And so, you know, supporting people through these really tough times is really, really important. We talked a bit as a committee, too. We're all, or the two of us here anyway, working in very large hospitals, investigating incidents that occur quite rarely in smaller hospitals. How do you do that? How do you support them? Do you have groups of hospitals that come together? But I think actually there's a role of the OHA here to actually come together and put together a training initiative. We did a story on healthy debate a few months ago. I should have looked at it last night before I came here, but that did, there are groups around, in particular, I think we found a couple places in the States that actually had some programs have been developed, but I do really think it's super important because we forget how, like, you know, it's obviously worse for the patients, but it's also really bad for the staff.
Often the experiences, as Andreas has said, are similar, and at some point in the healing process, bringing if provider and patient or family member want to come together. What we're seeing from a patient and family side is there's greater healing when that occurs and when both parties want to meet and share their experiences. Patients and families are incredibly understanding of what providers are going through. And again, the natural instinct is to keep the parties apart when in fact, nine times out of 10, patient and family want to meet with the people directly involved and see the compassion and the empathy. So just I'll throw that out there.
Okay, so we'll open it up to the audience for questions or comments that you might have for any of our presenters or to share your own insights about using QCIPA. While you think about it, I might just also remind everybody and maybe get our panel to comment if they wish, is that QCIPA actually, it does apply to more, you know, providers than hospitals. I think what we observed during our review is that it's not used very frequently in those settings, so in long-term care and in independent health facilities as well, also have, they also can have the protection of QCIPA. I think perhaps in long-term care homes that are affiliated with a hospital, you know, we might see it used there, but broadly in the sector, that type of analysis doesn't happen. And so, you know, I do think that the hospital sector, you know, it's important to improve the model and get it right, because it might serve as a model for those other sectors as they perhaps use QCIPA to do more root cause analysis of incidents in their institutions. So I didn't know if anybody had a comment on that.
Thank you. Said it well.
Yeah. Or anyone from the audience, perhaps, who's not from the hospital sector and who might use this or think it might be useful in their own setting. I think the other issue that comes up quite a lot is, you know, just that really, you know, to Sharon's point about the fight or flight, you know, how do we get people to not be afraid to identify an incident or to know it when they see it, or, you know, to flag a near miss or that type of thing. So, Tara.
We have a this is a like a little tip. So we during Patient Safety Week, which all of you know, I know, is in a couple of weeks, we give an award for near misses. So we have people apply for an award where if you recorded a near miss in the incident reporting system and your unit or your program or implemented a change to improve patient safety as a result of that incident, we give out an award. So it's an opportunity. We're trying to encourage reporting of good catches in the hospital. So we found that's really helped the dialogue on so if anyone's looking for kind of an easy way of doing it in your own organization, I'll let you know how it goes, because it's the first time we're doing it this year and we're giving them out Patient Safety Week. So, but we've had loads of interest in that, so that's been really great. What was your other? It was
about how we just get people to not be afraid to report.
Another, what we do on the physician side is quality improvement and patient safety rounds. So the purpose of those is to take incidents, much like morbidity, mortality rounds, and I think the more we do that, and the more we have physicians and frontline leaders who've been engaged in, who have had experiences, and all providers have had experiences, whether they're critical incidents or not, have them tell the story and their story. That has been incredibly compelling and incredibly brave. Now, we don't have lineups of people asking to do this yet, but we have had a few really great leaders within our organization stand up and share their experiences, and I think that's helped us from a culture perspective. We've got a way to go, but that's helped.
I'm just going to add just very very briefly on that, and sort of having seen this a few times, I'm going to say, as part of it, being really clear on what your discipline indicators are, and being really clear, and so that your staff all understand what you are going to discipline for and what you aren't going to discipline for. Because as part of promoting quality of care and getting people into that, I think everybody accepts that there are certain circumstances, intentional misconduct or done it six times despite trying to help people, that do call for discipline. But otherwise, if you're in a quality process, you get people to participate by making sure they understand they're not going to be disciplined for participating.
Yeah. Okay, I think we'll maybe start with the question at the back and then the front.
Sorry. Hi there, I'm Carol Fancott from Toronto Rehab UHN. Thanks very much for the panel. I'd like to pick up on something that Sharon had commented on about the role of patients and family members in the review of incidents. So whether it be as patient advisors on quality of care committees that are reviewing some of these critical incidents, or in the review process itself of the incident that caused harm to them or their family members. And I'm wondering if you could speak to the experience that any of you have had in this engagement process. And I'd also like to ask, where is the apology in all of this, and where does that sit? I was listening to a program on CBC, and I think I missed the first part of it, but they were talking about how because of legal risk, there were many jurisdictions that didn't want to start with the apology in terms of being then held culpable as a result. And so I wanted to, and I know I think that's in the disclosure guidelines, but.
Well, maybe Patrick can talk about the Apology Act. I can talk about the engagement of patients. So at Trillium, we have patients on our quality improvement patient safety. We have a patient representative on our quality improvement patient safety committee where all critical incidents are reported and the recommendations are reported. And he's very active. He's a patient and also a longtime volunteer. And so it is helpful to have that patient voice at the table. The quality of care committee is where all incidents come, and including critical incidents. We don't have a patient rep on that committee, although our board members, who are patients and community members, do come and sit in on those panels on occasion. I think where the opportunity is, at least from a hospital acute care sector, is how do we appropriately engage patients through the process. Sharon talked about making sure we communicate what the process is. I think we do a decent job of that through our patient relations process, but it's more, we want to let you know this occurred, so the disclosure may happen at the bedside, depending on the type of incident. We want to let you know that this occurred. There will be an incident analysis. Here's the process that is underway, and we'll meet with you when it's over to tell you what the recommendations were. We need to do a better job at determining how to engage patients, not just at the beginning, sharing the process and when it's over, but actually throughout. So I think that's a real opportunity for us in acute care.
I'm just going to add a remark or a comment to Tara's. So I think leading edge organizations include the patient and family in the process. They should, and often begin with hearing from the patient and family. What did they see? What did they observe? Starting with the patient and family, that seems patient and family centered to me. And as patients and families, we want to be part of the process. We don't want to just have to wait to the report at the very end.
Can I just follow up with that? One of the challenges we found is that anyone who does this for a living, and I'm sure there are many of you in the audience who do, we want to get this completed as soon as possible. And there are some cases where patients are not ready and families are not ready to talk at that time. So we need to be flexible whereby we can open it back up when the patient and or family is ready to talk about it. Because in the event when it's led to a premature death or major harm, some patients want to be engaged in the hospital. And our experience has been we will do that in that case. In other cases, we'll respect the family or patient who says, you know what? I don't want to talk to you right now, but then they might come back 6, 12, 18 months later.
So I'll add two things from the legal perspective. Number one is right now there's draft regulations under the Public Hospitals Act that are out for consultation that will require, as part of a critical incident review, that the patient or family member authorized representative be interviewed as part of a critical incident process. So that will become part of the law, assuming again the regulations get passed, at least for hospitals. Second thing on the question of apologies are totally okay. There is legislation on the books in Ontario that says an apology cannot be used in any legal process at all, and it's not taken as an admission of fault or responsibility. So an apology is totally fine.
It's too bad Angela Morin, the co-chair of the committee, isn't here, because she is a patient and family advisor at the Kingston General Hospital. And I know that Angela felt fairly strongly. I'm not sure 100% of the committee members agree with her, but I got a lot of respect for Angela. So that there's a difference between someone who's an employee of the hospital in terms of interacting with the patients and someone who is, like herself, an advisor to the hospital, but is actually not paid by the hospital. I'd be interested to hear whether you think that's true. And so, and frankly, talking to patients
during the process of writing the report, we heard both good and bad things about, I don't know what the right term is, but the patient liaison or the patient relations officer in the hospital, with in some instances patients really feeling that that person had their best interests at heart, was leading them through the process, was educating them, and others, the patient actually felt that that person actually was kind of more or less protecting the hospital and doing the opposite. And so Angela would say that having someone like a patient or family advisor who was actually not employee of the hospital, maybe being a member of the investigation committee, might be a good thing. I mean, we all thought, and I think the legislation says that, that assuming they want to be, that, that patients and family members should be interviewed about what about the critical incident. None of us thought that they should be involved in the actual investigation of their own critical incident. But I think a number of us also thought that it would make sense, actually, to have, if you will, a patient rep or someone with a patient view on the kind of committee that investigates these incidences.
Hi. My name is Valerie, and I'm a primary care provider in Sarnia in a primary care practice. I think that critical incidents, you know, I've worked in healthcare long enough, I know they're there. but I just wonder if any of you have a mechanism for having primary care report back on an incident that might come to light later. Because certainly in primary care, the patients surface with us and oftentimes have had time to digest their experience. And they don't know how to bring it forward without following through, you know, making it seem like a complaint when really they just want an answer. And, you know, certainly I have a number of patients in my practice that have had some bad experiences but feel they can't get anywhere with getting any answers. You know, or perhaps it's something that got missed. You know, recently I had a patient in the eMERGE, had a foreign body in his foot, was sent home to wait for the referral and consultation that never came, and finally took himself to another center, ended up getting an amputation. You know, like there's these kinds of things that go on, and I wonder if you have a mechanism for primary care providers to be involved in that.
We don't have a formal mechanism. You know, my advice to you is to strongly encourage your patient to reach out to their most responsible physician who provided their care. And if they're not comfortable doing that, to contact patient relations, who will hopefully ensure that they help the patient navigate the system that way. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it probably also depends on how, you know, if you're a primary care provider who has privileges in the hospital, which yes, many primary care providers do, then you can maybe help navigate that way. But there isn't a formal mechanism, but it's a thoughtful comment on, because I think all of us are nodding, because I think as patients ourselves, yeah, because we're all patients, or we're like, yeah, that's...
Well, certainly there's the fear for some patients, if mm-hmm, they're in the midst of a plan of treatment, that if they speak up about something that wasn't going exactly how they envisioned, that their care will then maybe change or suffer, or they'll get put off. Or
so here's the irony. I recently had surgery, foot surgery, and I have an SSI, a surgical site infection, and that's exactly how I felt.
Yes.
Wasn't at my hospital, just yeah, for the record.
Can I just ask you, the patient that it sounds like was sent home from eMERGE with the infection and then led to an amputation, did you, as maybe the patient's advocate and the primary care physician, reach out to the hospital on the patient's behalf, or did you think of that? Or?
Well, it's one of those things where you kind of tread lightly in a way. Like, it's like if the patient's not freaking out about the fact that they fell through the cracks, do you sort of point it out to them that, you know, I said to him, this shouldn't have happened, but, you know, it was one of, he's still trying to heal, he had to have skin grafting, blah, 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 blah. You know, so it's one of those things where you're trying desperately as the primary care provider, you're the quarterback of their care, right? So you're trying to not throw anybody else's care or institution under the bus, because you know we all need each other. So it's just a delicate thing, and I just wonder, you know.
Look, I think we're all strong advocates of a complete system of care, so it's sure, not about, you know, primary care's done, over to acute care, over to long-term care. I think as patients, we expect whomever is looking out for us to look out for us for the whole journey. And the primary care provider is such a great person, you know, person to help do that. I know that's challenging from a time perspective, but you know, I think we can't hesitate to do that. And it's critical from the purview of the patient that someone sees their whole case.
Yeah.
And we need to create mechanisms to make that easier and not confrontational. Mm-hmm. Because I can understand where you're coming from.
Thank you.
Just a little segue there. So in terms of transitions, you know, they are the most unsafe places for us as patients and family members. And I think one of the speakers last year, a family from Alberta, talked about that. I just want to, because I think it's really important that we have this discussion here, not just in your province, but in every province. So who will be the keeper of those patients who really feel that their incidents need to be looked at from a system more than just one care provider or one organization? I don't know. Is it a role of the ministry? Is it a role of the ombudsman or advocate? There needs to be a place from our perspective where we can go for those situations, you know, with the backing of the physician most involved. But really good point. Mm-hmm. Really good system flaw. Good catch.
Let's fix it, guys.
Yeah, let's fix it.
Hi, it's Gord Wallace. I'm the managing director of the Safe Medical Care Group at the CMPA. And the CMPA, the Canadian Medical Protective Association, is the is a group that has all Canadian physicians are members of the CMPA. So we have about 94,000 members. In response to that question, we would encourage a member who was asking that question about how to make an issue of care known to the hospital or another provider, for mm-hmm. that example, we would ask them to think, well, they may not understand all the facts and circumstances of the challenges that the other providers were facing at the time, but we would encourage them to speak with the other provider, or mm-hmm. failing that, if there was a discomfort in doing that, to approach the chief of department or others in a constructive, professional way, bring forward the issue so that corrections can be addressed. So I think that's one very solid approach to this. And I think as a culture in healthcare, we have to also become receptive to that input, because I think there's been great sensitivity in the past, and sometimes those comments might not have been appreciated. But I think that we're changing, and it's important that we bring forward those issues in care. I did want to comment on a couple of things. One is the important role of apology, because I think sometimes CMPAs messages around apology are misunderstood. We get well over 100, perhaps 150 calls a day from physicians across Canada that are concerned about something that went on in care. And some of those are related to, should we disclose, what are our obligations? We have trained medical officers that guide them through the disclosure process. It aligns with the Canadian Patient Safety Incident Disclosure Process guidelines. And our own materials, we just recently published on those also again, and there's a handbook on our website that I think people might find valuable. We encourage apology, appropriate apology, so that if, and what we say is express your empathy and sympathy for a patient, learn what the facts of the case are, and then go back to the patient. And if you had a role in what was to play, apologize to the patient and acknowledge that role. What we also say is if there were others involved, a hospital, for example, then it is that hospital's, if there were processes or failures in the systems of care, we'd ask the organization to apologize to the patient on behalf of the organization. So I think might help clear up some of this. I really appreciated Sharon's comments, because I think one of the frustrations I hear constantly about QCIPA was that the patient would learn something that things had gone wrong, perhaps some of the facts, and then it would be months before there was any real report back. And so I think it really is about establishing expectations of what QCIPA is about. QCIPA does not protect facts. What it was meant to do was prevent the sort of misconstruing of opinions or hypotheses or second guesses. It was And so I think it's very important that patients be constantly made aware of the facts as these evolve, and also what the actual outcomes of the QCIPA review are likely to be. And they're going to be recommendations. Well, it doesn't even matter what, if it's QCIPA or not, all right? They need to know what that review is likely going to be telling them, and that the and that will be expectations. We're going to try to develop recommendations that will, and implement these, that will prevent this, the likelihood of a similar event in the future.
I think that brings the, we can have time for one more. We have a couple minutes.
Great, thank you. Good session, interesting topic. My question relates to critical incidents being a trigger for a QCIPA review potentially, but concurrently also a professional practice review about staff or about a physician. Mm-hmm. Would the panel have any comments with respect to teasing out the relationship between a QCIPA review and the level of disclosure or transparency about a concurrent separate process for professional practice reviews?
It's an excellent question. It's hugely gray. I can look at the incidents below and tell you that in some cases there were practice issues. In none of those cases were they exclusively practice issues. There were systems and process contributors to those incidents. What we try to do is separate those two processes. So if it's a physician practice issue, the chief of the department manages the profession, the practice issue, or the manager of the unit or director of the unit manages it if it's an allied or nursing issue. And then our review focuses on the systems and process opportunities for improvement. But it's incredibly gray and often difficult, and because they're happening in parallel. And I found that very practically that's especially difficult for our leadership on the front line to be able to separate those two things. When it comes to patient disclosure, we disclose what the facts of what occurred and whether or not that was practice related or systems or process, they will hear the facts of what occurred. But I think you bring up a very practical challenge for us on a day-to-day basis in this environment, and how do you do it well and continue to foster a just culture, which is I think why we moved away from the no blame culture to a just culture. But it's there's nuance and it's very challenging.
And having seen these things challenged or debated in a legal process, I'll say from a practical perspective, number one, if it's at all possible, decide at the outset whether you're heading down a discipline process or not. Because if you head down the quality process route and you take something that you find out of the quality process and you turn that into a discipline process, or it becomes a discipline process, and that's whether it's a QCIPA or not. Mm-hmm. If you've started down the quality route, you take something you learned out of the quality route and then try to turn that into discipline,
don't do that.
Every other staff person who's ever involved in a quality review the next time around is going to be suspicious about the process.
Yeah.
So if at all possible, do discipline first. If your institutional size and structure allows it, do it with when you're doing them in parallel, and sometimes you do have to do them in parallel, do it with different people.
Yeah.
So that there is no inadvertent, I'll call it cross-pollination or crossing over. Because when you get into the challenged processes, either from a labor relations perspective or a CMPA perspective, they're going to fight you on if you've taken the quality information and tried to, even inadvertently or unintentionally, turn that into discipline information.
Yeah.
And sometimes you're going to find something out in a quality process that in very rare circumstances says, we got to turn this into something else, but that's got to be exceedingly rare.
Just a quick follow-up. Should patients be informed that there's a disciplinary process underway?
I have no issue if there is a disciplinary process or that is something that's being considered. Again, I think that's part of the information that can be provided to the patient.
Thank you.
Thanks to the panel, and a comment on Michelle's reference to other sectors. I come from a family health team sector, so my question is, would QCIPA be applicable to primary care? And if family health teams were to start implementing, how would we define our critical incidents? Are there references, or can we refer to the hospital's experience? What would be your advice?
I guess no. Like the question of whether QCIPA applies is no, right? Currently, it's not set out as one of the areas that you could sort of invoke this. And my understanding of, you know, defining critical incidents is that is something. I think that's an area that probably needs some work. I know it took quite a lot to get the hospital sector to kind of concur on the definition that found itself in the Public Hospitals Act, and if people have flagged, there's still some ambiguity in that definition. I think it's defined, from my understanding, slightly differently in long-term care, yes. In independent health facilities or out-of-hospital premises. It's all slightly different, and I think at some point we probably need to pull up a little bit mm-hmm. and consider from a patient's perspective, regardless of where they're getting their care, if it sort of looks and feels the same, it probably should find itself in a similar category. So I think that's probably an area where we'll see some work underway in the future.
And I can't speak to the, I'll say the legislative agenda, but recognizing that this notion of protection clashes with the other principles of accountability, transparency, and disclosure, I see the idea of extending the QCIPA protection as a good thing, mm-hmm. but where it's required. But I think given the clash with accountability and transparency, I think it's going to be very slowly, if at all, extended to other circumstances. What I do see as more likely is the extension of mandatory requirements around review and patient involvement and mm-hmm. patient disclosure for critical incidents, and that being extended out to mm-hmm. other regulated sectors or other types of practice environments. I see that as more likely.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, so that is time, or slightly beyond time, I believe. So thank you all so much for joining our session today, and thank you to our panelists. There is lunch waiting for you. It's in the exhibit hall, I've been told. So if you're looking for it, that's where it is, not the KPMG lunch at the other end of the hall. So thanks once again. I think this is going to remain a sort of active file and an active issue in Ontario as we work through the legislation and the implementation.